So we start from where I live, we live yesterday, as just a few words about the turbulent combustion noise. I am just considering the following experiment. You have a burner, a turbulent premixed burner. This is a sketch of the a cross-section of the turbulent frame front. And what we are looking at is what is the kind of noise that this burner is going to produce, okay? You know, just I recall you some basic result concerning the sound emission, what is called in the literature monopolar sound emission. What that? Take a solid sphere and make the radius of this solid sphere pulsating, for example. This is going to radiate sound, okay? Now, so you have a deformable small body with fluctuating velocity v, and it's not difficult for assume it is spherical and assume that the size of this spherical body is small compared to the wavelength of the acoustics in the air. So this is the potential of the acoustic flow, and this potential, it's not so difficult to obtain its shape, general shape, where V dot V is simply the derivative of the volume, and you know it is shifted by the time it take by the acoustic wave to propagate from the origin, where is the small volume, to the place R, at the radius R. It is a spherical problem, okay? This is divided by 1 over R because of this geometrical symmetry, geometry. And so now, when you know the potential, you know the flow, you know the flow velocity. This is a longitudinal, excuse me, is a radial component of the flow, of the acoustic flow velocity. And now the energy, the radiate flux of energy, which is called also intensity of sound, it's a flux of energy, is simply mass density times sound, the speed of sound times the average of the square of the velocity. You see, rho v square, this is an energy per unit volume, times the velocity, it is an energy per unit surface and per unit time. So this is what we call sound intensity, okay? And this sound intensity is related simply to the amplitude of fluctuation of the volume. But you know, this volume can fluctuate not necessarily in a periodic. It can be stochastic, whatever it is. This equation is right. And then from this solution here, you have the intensity of the sound in terms of the second derivative of the with respect to time of the volume square average. Average on time sufficiently long, for example, if it is periodic on the period and so on. So now from this idea, simple, this is a simple exercise. For sound generation. Now, if you consider a flame, remember that a flame acts as a semi-permeable piston. So it is the same thing. You know, the variation of the surface of the flame is going to make fluctuate. It's similar to a volume. The volume that you have to be considered is the mass flow rate of burned gas in the laboratory frame, total mass flow rate, divided by the density of the burn gas, because you are because this is the approximation that I am doing to use here, which is not very realistic, is that the air outside is just burned gas. When you have a real burner, it's not exactly that, because at infinity, you have the air, okay? And so there is a mixing between air and burned gas. Burned gas are only close to the wave, and then you have a mixing. But I forget this detail. It's not a detail because it changed of all the unity, the result, but not qualitatively, okay? Because so I assume that the outside air atmosphere is burned gases. So uniform burned gases. So in that case, the equivalent of the volume variation equivalent to this problem, equivalent to the spherical sphere, is this one. This is a change of volume that you have to take into account to predict the sound. Now, you see, here on this equation here, I have written the mass flow rate of burned gas. What I did? I use the normal flame velocity in the laboratory frame plus the burned gas velocity. So this gives you what is the velocity of the gas, which is a burned gas, which is outside from the flame, and you integrate over the flame. You multiply by the density of the burned gas, and you have the total mass flow rate of burned gas. But no, what is difficult here is that you have this normal flame velocity that you don't like to keep with you. So what you do is you write exactly the same relation for now the fresh mixture. Okay, you are looking exactly. So this is the mass flow rate of fresh gas in the laboratory frame, where DF is normal, but now you have the laminar flame speed. Here you have the burned gas flame speed in the referential frame of the flame. So, and this is a mass conservation relation. So you eliminate, you take the difference of that, and what do you obtain? You obtain that the flow, this quantity, you subtract this quantity from this quantity, this is equal to that, and now on the other side you have this thing, and you know what is important now, if you assume that your burner, that the flow outside the pipe is constant, this does not play any role because it is a constant. So because I need the derivative with respect to time. So this is not useful for me. What is useful is this, where S now is the instantaneous surface of the flame. And this instantaneous surface of the flame is associated to the turbulence of the flow, right? In fact, if the flow is not turbulent, take a Bunsen burner, there is no noise. Or you may have a slight noise coming from the vortex shedding, but not from the combustion. So the combustion is coming from the fact that this time derivative is varying in time, so that this second derivative is non-zero. This means that the variation, the time derivative of the surface is going to produce the sound. All right, so so this is what I have written here, and now here this is the equation that you obtain for the intensity of the sound as in the same way as we obtain for a solid fluctuating volume. This was obtained by it is not new; it's known by Strahler. And now you, in the same way now, that as soon as you know the intensity of the sound, you may compute the power spectrum of the sound simply by taking the autocorrelation function of dot S, which is d over dts. You see, this is exactly a similar relation. This tells you what is the frequency content of the frequency, this tells you what is the power spectrum of the sound in terms of the autocorrelation function of the derivative of the flame surface. So now, when you know this result, the only thing you need is to compute this time derivative here of the surface in terms of the turbulence. Okay, this you can, what I did some time ago with Eric Sidja, which is who is a bright physicist, and now he's working in biology. He is at Rockefeller Institute, in New York. So what we did is simply we use the fact, first of all, you may, with this equation here, you may easily obtain the order of magnitude of the sound using a Kolmogorov cascade, using exactly the same result that I have developed yesterday in the last lecture concerning the turbulent flame speed in the limit of I have described when the flow velocity is much larger than the Kolmogorov velocity and much smaller than the integral velocity of the cascade. And in that case, you obtain, when you do that, I skip the details. The details are complicated. If some the people who are interested have to read this paper. If I remember well, it is published in Combustion Science and Technology or something like that. I don't remember exactly, but you find it with the date and the name. You find the paper, and what you obtain in that case is the spectrum of the sound, if it is, if the hypothesis are right, this very strong hypothesis concerning the flame velocity and so on, and the Kolmogorov cascade, which is not so clear that it is the case. But if you do that, you find that the spectrum decrease like a power of the energy spectrum decrease as a power of the frequency, and this power is -5/2. This -5/2 comes from two things. It comes from the Kolmogorov cascade that I have described, and from the shape of the flame. I forgot the name. So you got this -5/2 exponent here. And very surprising. So first of all, there was an experiment. When we wrote this paper, we did not know this experiment. This experiment has been shown to us by experimentalists in my lab, when I asked them, okay, could you try to verify this result if it is right or not? And finally, they found out, before starting to do something, they looked to the bibliography and to the paper, and they found a paper for a very large burner, you know, very large experiment done by Russian. And very surprisingly, they found exactly the same exponent experimentally. So we were very happy with that. And but you know, I want to tell you that don't be so impressed by the exponent when the exponents are working. Because, you know, when you do not take sufficient scale, it's easy to obtain a tangent. And with this tangent, depending on the place where you look to the tangent, you find the exponent you like. So you have to be careful in experiment with this. But here, it works for 2 decades. It's not so bad. To have an exponent in 2 decades, this begins to be relevant, let's say. We may are confident on this result. So, this exponent was based on the fractal dimension of the surface and on the Kolmogorov cascade. So in a sense, the analysis that I have presented to you yesterday is not so bad. Okay, now I ask the people in my lab to say, okay, do the experiment because to see. And they do the experiment and they take a blowtorch. You know what is a blowtorch? It's a, you know, okay. When they, before to do anything, they measure the intensity of the sound. They compare to our formula. And this intensity of a blowtorch was 2 orders of magnitude larger in the experiment than in the theory, while it works very well for the very large burner. And this is a very interesting comparison. And finally, the experimentalists, not me, understood very well what happened. It turns out that the turbulence is very weak here, coming out from this blood touch, because there is a contraction and the flow is very weakly turbulent, not sufficiently turbulent to produce this. But look at this picture here. You know, this is a blowtorch. This is a cross section of the blowtorch using the method, the tomography laser method of Louis Boyer. And what do you see? You see there is nothing. There is no fluctuation on the basis of the. But you see the fluctuation increase here. And finally, you end up with a very strongly fluctuating tip. Why it is like that? Because you have an amplification of the small disturbance on the basis due to the small turbulence by the interesting instability of the frame. When Sirby and a PhD, she was a girl, I don't remember the name, she was a nice girl. And they did maybe I put the name somewhere. Ah, no, I did not put the name. Okay, that's a pity. So, what I want to say is that now when they take into account the amplification of the distortion of the flame by the intrinsic instability, hydrodynamical instability of the flame, they got the right answer, in order of magnitude. At least to begin with, you have to be okay with the order of magnitude. And then they went further, and they found that even the spectrum is not so bad. Okay, this is what I want to say I will now change topic. Okay, so. This is what I wanted to say about the emission, sound emission by turbulent flames. You know, it is an important topic, because you know that in a plane, the engine of plane, the noise that you hear in the engine, 1/3 of this noise is coming from turbulent combustion. So it is important, because if you can slow down even 1/3 of the power. But you know that what the ear is sensitive not to the power, but to the logarithm of the power, okay? So it's very important to decrease the sound emitted by the turbulent frame. So no, this is not that. All right, now should be now. What is the number of the lecture? 10. Okay, it is 10. Yes, it should be 10. 10. Ah. Okay. Now we are changing topic. We are entering in, you know, what I did in this lecture, I start with quasi-isobaric mechanism of flame. Then I begin to talk about some compressible effect by acoustic coupled to the flame. And now I go to a fully compressible combustion phenomena, okay? As I told you in my first lecture, it was observed from a long time, from the 19th century, in fact, that you have some wave, combustion wave, propagating at the supersonic velocity. In that case, the low Mach number approximation cannot work, and this phenomena should be fully compressible. You know, you have to take into account the compressibility. You cannot get rid of dp over dt in the energy equation. Now, the dp over dt in the energy equation becomes dominant effect. So, okay. In this first lecture, I don't know if I can do that in 1 hour. We will see. What I want to do is first to give you the background. You know, what are the status of this planar supersonic wave, and I will start with shock waves. And I would like to make you understood why we are producing shock wave, how the shock wave is produced. This is something that it is not, you know, there is no many course about that because this is a, let's say, an old topic. It was very fashionable in the 50s because, and now, we forget about that. I don't know. It is stupid because it is a very important topic and it's back now. Let me tell you that even in the topic of detonation are back in research activity. So it is good to know the background. So I will spend some time in the background. Then I will spend, if I have time, to explain you what is the structure of shock waves. How can we describe a shock wave? Then the structure, planar and steady, propagating at constant velocity. Then a detonation, and then I would like to tell you some word why, how the Chapman-Jouguet, I will explain you what it is, wave is selected. Because there is one typical wave which is selected in detonation. So let me start with the background, and this background is due to Riemann. You know, Riemann is a famous mathematician, very fortunately, his paper, basic paper, he's a mathematician, was translated in English, 10 and 20 years ago. So it's very interesting to read. So the people who are interested, who are working in compressible phenomena, should read the paper of Riemann, even if it is difficult to read. This Riemann was incredible. First of all, he was a mathematician. He knows perfectly the physics of gas, perfectly. And he found out, in fact, he was able to understand why shocks are formed, but he was interested in the following question. He said, acoustic is linear. Everybody knows how to do that. We linearize the equation and so on. What happened if I took some nonlinear term u grad u? Let's say small. And he found out that he found a new method of solving the hyperbolic equation, showing that a singularity appears at a finite time in the solution, which means that the problem in math is not well posed, because if you form a singularity in a finite time, something should be missing in the formulation of the problem. But this singularity is a shock wave. And he was so modest that he said, I am not sure that this can be helpful for physicists. You know, he discovered the shock wave, but he said maybe it is not useful for physicists. But maybe the method will be useful. The new method that I described could be useful to solve hyperbolic equation, you know. And to tell you also another theory is Ernst Mach, the Mach number, the man who developed the Mach number, did very, very good experiment like that. He put a gun, vertical gun, fires a gun, the bullet go out, and he take a Schlieren picture of that. And he noticed a parabolic discontinuity just in front of the bullet. And he say, oh, this can, he was an experimentalist, hein, Mach. And he say, oh, this could be related to what Professor Riemann found in his equation. So this was a fantastic time, you know. The end of the 19th century was a fantastic time, really. Because so bright people, so modest, and so on. Let me show first. I will take some. I will. No, I don't want to be too fast in the basic things. Let me first try to make you understand very simply how you are forming singularity after a finite time in hyperbolic equation. You know, take this equation here, written here. Where, you know, see, when this velocity A is not, now is, you know, it is a scalar equation where you have, and it is one dimensional and time dependent, okay? It's a simple equation. If the velocity A is constant, A naught, the solution of this equation is immediately found. It's simply the propagation of, without deformation of the initial condition. Okay, this is very easy. And you have only one direction here of propagation because you have only one time derivative. If you look to the Poisson equation, you have two and you have two directions. Here you have only one, right? So now, this is not the work of Riemann. Riemann was working immediately with the acoustic, but I want to give you some more easy way to understand that. Maybe you know already, I don't know. If you don't know, it's a good thing. So now assume that this quantity A is varying with the amplitude U. It's a nonlinear variation. Or maybe it could be linear, but this term now is nonlinear because it's a multiplication of two quantities that depends on U. But it's easy to understand that if the solution, you know, now in the phase space, you looked for trajectory such that dx over dt, that is the velocity of the point you are considering, is exactly a u. Ah, you don't know what it is. You say it is like. This is called a characteristic of the equation. In that case, the quantity the total derivative of u following this trajectory x in terms of t is constant. Why? Because now the partial derivative of A with respect to t plus dx over dt partial derivative of u relative to x is a total derivative of the quantity u, or what is called also the material derivative if u is a flow velocity. Okay? So now you find out immediately that on this, if there are these characteristics, are necessarily straight line because u is constant, so AU is constant, so the solution is a straight line. So u is constant along straight lines that are given here, where x naught is the position that at time t equals zero, and a naught, is a velocity that you are considering at the initial position t equals zero, where u equals u zero. So now it's easy to understand the formation of a singularity. Why? Take a bump as an initial condition for u. Assume that the quantity A, velocity, is an increasing function with u, for example. Okay? Now you see that at the top of the bump, the velocity is larger than at the basis of the bump. Okay? So it's clear that now, if you are going faster here than here, you are going to have a wave breaking. But if you are considering something that cannot have, multiple value, you know, so something should be stopped somewhere. Because, for example, if you are considering a flow, you cannot have two flow velocity at the same point. Or here you will have three. One, two, three. That's not possible. So something is, you have to stop the analysis before the wave breaking, that at the time where the slope become vertical here. And now this is clearly understood in terms of the characteristic. If you look to the characteristic, you find that the characteristics are going to cross each other. But because each characteristic propagates a well-defined value of u, which is different from one characteristic to the other, you have a multi-value problem, which is here. So this, for example, is well known in optics. You know, this is the envelope of the characteristic. I don't remember what the name in optics. What's the name of this strange phenomena when you have a ray of light? No. There is a name. Okay, I will. It will come back later. My mind is, you know, is getting old. So, c'est la caustic. How do you know? You know this word caustic. In French, I don't know in English. Have you heard of that? No. Okay. When you look, for example, and you send a ray in the lens. When you send a ray, if the length is perfect, the radius of the ray of light are collapsing in one point. Okay, if the length is perfect, but the length is never perfect, so the line, you know, does not cross at the same place, and you are forming this kind of swallow. I don't know. This is called a caustic in French. I don't know in English. It's an optical problem. Classic. It's a classical problem in optics. But forget about. We are not concerned with optics here. We are concerned that, you know, from a mathematical point of view, it is the same problem. So now we can do better. We can also predict the time at which You have to stop the calculation because it has no meaning from a physical point of view, because you obtain a multiple value solution that has no meaning. For example, if it is a flow, you cannot have three flow velocity at one position in the flow. That's not possible. For the wave on the shore, this is possible. You know, if the quantity u is the height of the wave, you can have, you know, this is the wave breaking. This is okay for a wave, for the height of a bump. But it cannot be possible if it is a flow velocity in a pipe. That's not possible for a flow velocity in a pipe. So this is why I call that wave breaking. Maybe it's not a good term, but I prefer, it's clear for me, at least for me. Now, well, it's very easy to find out the time at which the slope is going to be infinite. You change, you know, you say because you are constant along the characteristics, you inverse the relation between x and the initial position at time equal to zero, and this should be constant. U naught is the initial velocity, so you inverse this, you obtain, you use the trajectory here, you use, now you take the derivative and you find out the derivative of x in terms of the initial condition, in terms of the time, and the derivative, the initial derivative of the profile of the flow velocity. Now you inverse that, you put that in this equation, you derive du over dx, it is du over dx naught time dx naught divided, and then you have in the denominator, you have 1 plus t equal dA naught over dx naught. So when dA naught over dx naught is negative, when time is increasing, the denominator goes through zero, blow up. Okay? So you have to stop at that time, but you have to stop to the first time at which this occurs. So you have to look for the highest slope that you have here, and this is at the inflection point here. So the picture is the following, that an initial bump is going to become singular at this time here, which is well defined, which is the where now, and this is only in the for negative, it's not, you know, in the positive part there is no problem. In the negative part of the slope, you have a divergence of the denominator when t equals this value, and then you have to take the smallest time at which it occurs, and this is for the strongest slope. And this, and when you have this, you have the time of wave breaking, and so you may predict immediately that this equation is going, is ill, this problem is, from a mathematical point of view, ill posed for sufficiently long time. At all? This is a very, very deep result, you know. It looks very simple, but this is very, very deep result. You will see why. Okay. Now, what did Riemann, he said, okay, what happened when the singularity occurred? It was not sufficient for him to understand the occurrence of the instability, the singularity. He wanted to know what happened afterward. And then, because he knows the existence of shock waves, because shock waves were known before, from the beginning of the 18th century by Stokes and people like Poisson, Stokes, and so on, were very concerned by what are shock waves, because they already know shock waves. So he wanted, so he did, and then he did a mistake. You know, even the best the best scientist even did mistake. And the mistake he did, he conserved the entropy and tried to find the propagation of the discontinuity by keeping the entropy constant across the frame. And this is an error, as you are going to see. The entropy is not constant across a shock wave. But it was right for very small shock wave, intensity very weak, because the jump of the entropy is of third order, as you will understand. So in a sense, what he did later on was not good for strong shock, but was good to begin with the formation of the shock, you know, to begin with the formation of the shock. So now let me try to in simple words, to explain the jump condition that you have to use across a discontinuity that is built by the solution. Okay, this seems natural. This is was the idea of Riemann, but Riemann did that with gas. I will do that with gas later, but I want to do that first to this equation, with this equation. What can I say? I said, okay, I would like to find a step function like that, u plus, u minus, propagating at a velocity d satisfying this equation. Does that exist? Yes, it does. What you do is simple. You say, okay, now I am looking for a solution where x and t varies like that with a velocity d, that it is unknown of the problem, and find the velocity d. Not difficult. You change variable. You find out an equation of this type, because you use that the time derivative is related to the space derivative times the velocity minus with a minus sign, because you change a variable. You put that here, and now you see that the space derivative is in front of everything if d is constant, and so you have you have a conserved scalar, which is g. I put here g because this g, I use here the g, the definition of g here, because this is a generalized way, it's a flux. So you have this flux minus du is constant. So what you obtain, because it is constant, it should be the same on both sides. So you have the relation for the velocity, and you are happy. You said, oh, I got the velocity of a discontinuous solution with a jump. You are happy, but this is wrong. It's not quite wrong. The problem is ill-posed. I may found the there are not only one solution to this problem. There are an infinite set of solutions. Why? It's just you multiply this equation by whatever you like, a function, and you will find another result, a different result. So the problem is not well posed. So the problem is mathematically, so your solution has no meaning. It is one solution, but there are many others. It turns out that excuse me. This is a surprise. Okay, problem is imposed, but it turned out that this solution here, this particular solution, is the one which is selected as soon as you put the slight dissipation mechanism. So what does that mean? If you add in your equation here, your on the right-hand side, a small dissipative term. You see, when you look to this term equal to this term, this is a diffusion equation that I have described in the previous lecture. So this second derivative in space is what we call a dissipative phenomena. And now you put an epsilon in front of it, very small. And when you do that, now you can solve the problem. You know, you may integrate in the same way you have integrated here, but you have now a derivative, and now you find an equation when you integrate that through the frame, through the profile. Now you don't know if it is. And you are going to find an equation for the solution. First order differential equation for the solution with the epsilon here. That can be with a constant term here, which is coming because you integrate across. This is zero, so the function is a constant. And this constant should be the same in all the solution. Now, when you integrate this equation, you obtain this form. And now you say du over dx should be zero on both sides, and you find out the expression of the constant here. Not only the expression of the constant, because you have two equations, but you are going to find the expression of the velocity. And look at that. Same expression as this one. Wonderful. Wonderful problem, mathematical problem. Simple one, simplest. You know, this is why I enjoy science, you know. Because sometimes you may understand very deep problem in simple terms. And this you see, as soon as I have an hyperbolic equation, and as soon I add a small dissipative term. You know what I can do is to take the limit epsilon go to zero. The thickness here that you obtain with this equation, you see the thickness is scaled by epsilon. The thickness go to zero, and you are back to the discontinuous solution. So you see, I don't know if you have already heard what I just say, but this should be taught to the student. And I am not sure that in the course of of hyperbolic problem or for the math, from the math point of view, they know that very well, that a small dissipative term is going to select a solution of problem which is imposed without. They know that very well. But they, in a sense, when you try to read the math paper on that, is a mess, you know, because they want to demonstrate rigorously, and it is difficult. But here, you know, you understand everything straightforward. It's straightforward. So let me tell you something more in this equation, and then I am going to go through the real shock. What I want to say is the following. You know, if now I use here, in this equation, I used AU equal U. This is a famous equation called Burger's equation. And this Burger's equation was solved around the 50s exactly by a transformation called the Hopf-Cole transformation. Those who are interested will find that the best way to find. Is a book of the man of Caltech. I don't remember. I'll tell you later. It is very well done in a book. So this I want just to let you know that there are cases where you have exact analytical solution, as we have for in the same way as we obtain a solution, whatever be the initial condition. So it's a very nice problem. Okay, now let me say some few words from a problem that you surely know. It's called the Riemann's invariant. It's also due to Riemann in the same paper that I have just mentioned. So what did Riemann? You know, Riemann, now I am back to the fluid mechanic problem. You know, now because we have understood the key points, we may now enter in more complex problem. The problem is more complex because you have at least, you have two equations of first order. And if you assume that you use the Euler equation, you assume constant entropy. Okay? And so there is no dissipative system in my problem for the moment. And I use ideal gas. So I have the relation of the sound speed here, and I have the relation of the isentropic condition, which is here, so that this is the continuity equation, okay, which is written exactly. And here I have written the Euler equation, replacing the pressure by the by its relation in terms of density using the speed of sound. And this is the general formulation of a 1D nonlinear 1D Euler equations. What did Riemann in a, it's not exactly like that, but when you look carefully, he multiplies this equation by a number lambda and he adds the two equations. When you do that, you have the lambda here, lambda here, lambda here. Now he say, I am going to seek for a value of lambda such that this term here is lambda times this term here. Why? Because in that case, I will have lambda times the same derivative here on both sides, on both terms. Okay. So when you want to that this term be equal to lambda times this term, you have this equation. It's a second order differential ordinary algebraic equation. You have two solutions for lambda. It's plus or minus a divided by rho. So lambda rho is plus or minus the sound speed. Okay. Now you put. Why do I rewrite? Oh yes. Now you know if you say that this is equal to that, you have this form of this equation, and now this is clear that now lambda. You know you see that lambda rho plus u time a particulate. The derivative along this equation, this x dx over dt equals that, you know, this is called the two characteristics you have, because lambda dx over dt equal plus or minus a over rho time rho plus u give you u plus rho, u plus a for one characteristic, u minus a for the second characteristic. So now, when you work on the plane x and time, you have along this characteristic, you know that along this characteristic, you are propagating invariants. What is the invariant? It is lambda d rho plus du. And now you use. This is the quantity that are conserved along the characteristic, and now you add the relation obtained that tells that gives you the relation between d rho over rho that you have here in terms of d a over a, where a is the speed of sound, using the ideal gas law, you obtain what is known the Riemann invariant. The Riemann invariants are the quantity that are conserved on this characteristics. So G plus is conserved on C plus, and G minus here is conserved on C minus. And now, to solve the problem for any time, knowing the initial condition, it's very easy. You look to the two characteristics that cross. When they cross at this point, you know, you have you should have G plus equal to G minus, and you find the solution. Okay? This is a method used by Riemann to solve the problem. Okay. It turns out that this problem has very simple solution for simple waves. What are simple waves? Simply are waves, one-dimensional waves, first of all, that are associated with the motion of a piston, a solid wall. Okay? So in that case, it's easy to prove that characteristic is linear. This is easy because it is when you know the reason is that in that region where the gas was initially at rest, okay, here it is a rarefaction wave. I move the piston backward, okay? And here, you know, for example, this characteristic minus, you know what it is, simply because here U equals zero initially, and A is called the A naught, which is the sum. So you know here, so you it's easy now to find the value of U and A on any characteristic C plus, and then find out that this A and U are constant on this characteristic, so the slope is constant, so it's finished. The characteristics are linear. This rarefaction wave, by this way, you solve completely the problem, of the fluid mechanic problem, when at time equal T zero, you retract the piston backward. No problem, this is what is called an expanding wave. You should be careful that the pressure does not go below zero. And this happens if the speed of the piston is so sufficiently fast, and so if the pressure arrives in zero at zero, you have to stop and to say, okay, I have now the expansion in the vacuum. When you have a duct which is a tube closed in the vacuum, and you take out the wall. The gas flows out, pressure is zero outside, and this solution is given by this, which is called the rarefaction wave. I don't want to discuss this point because I have no time. But now, assume that the piston is propagating towards the fluid. Now, once again, for the same reason, the characteristics, the C plus characteristics are linear, for the same reason. But now, the slope of the characteristics are increasing. You see, here the slope are decreasing, or it depends how you consider the slope. But let's say, it's clear on the picture. So in a sense, the slope is decreasing here, and it is increasing here. But what happened now is that the characteristics cross each other. So something you should stop, as we did with the first, the simple problems that I have discussed just before. There is a case, and I will stop here. There is a case that is very interesting. Is when the piston, when the motion of the piston is like that. Piston is quiet for T negative, for time, negative time, and at T equals zero, you put the piston at a velocity, a constant velocity. In that problem, when you look to the dimension of this problem, you have only one parameter, which is free, it is the velocity. So in that case, you should have self-similar solutions, which tells you that the only non-dimensional parameter relating x and t should be the ratio x divided by dt, by the velocity t. And this is called a self-similar solution. In that case, the problem is the following. Here is the trajectory of the shock. You have a piston. You have a shock in front of the piston. The piston is subsonic. I use a subsonic piston. And the shock wave is propagated in front of the piston at a supersonic speed. And the distance between the shock and the piston increase linearly with time as the difference of the two velocity, sound velocity, velocity of the shock minus velocity of the piston. Now, when you look to the rarefaction wave, now you have an interesting solution that using the characteristic of the solution of Riemann, that tell you that you go from the, the gas is at rest in this, on the right of this point, and it has the velocity of it is a velocity I put on the pressure. I don't see that. It is constant. It should be the velocity. It should be minus the velocity. Velocity of the, because I don't see, it is modulus of the velocity here of the piston. So the gas should follow the piston as C velocity. And the way to go from a quiet gas to a motion, to a gas in motion, is what is called an expanding wave, where this distance now here is increasing like here with time, but now the velocity is at each time linear in space. So you know the solution, and this is helpful to understand the solution, the selection of the Chapman-Jouguet solution in detonation. Now, let's take a break.